The next set of findings has to do with the influences on happiness. There is indeed a set point that restrains our amount of happiness, and we're able to bounce back from negative events, and sadly, positive events don't influence us as much. But none of this is to say that we aren't influenced by our world. We definitely are. For one thing, your life situation has an absolute effect on your happiness. So the simplest illustration of this is you go back to those data as to the happiness of people in different countries, and then you look at how rich their country is. And what you find, and maybe this is common sense, but the richer the country, the happier the people are on average. Similarly, happiness is largely influenced by how successful you are relative to the people around you. And this is an insight that's nicely expressed by H.L. Mencken, who wrote, "A wealthy man is one who earns $100 more than his wife's sister's husband." And what this means is we think relatively. We are social creatures, we are hierarchical creatures, and we're exquisitely sensitive to where we stand relative to other people. And you can see this as a thought experiment. Would you rather make $70,000 if everybody else in your office makes $65,000, or $75,000 if everyone else in your office makes $80,000? Well, your mileage may vary. I think a lot of people would simply choose the absolute number more, which is option B. But I think to some extent we'd be swayed by option A, where we're making absolutely less, but we're making more relative to other people. And in fact, the happiness literature suggests that one measure, one way to predict how happy somebody is not merely through their absolute income or absolute status in the world, but where they stand relative to other people. And some savvy negotiators know this. There's stories about Maria Callas and Stanley Fish, and they both go, there were both stories of the sort, they're negotiating, and the one demand that they make isn't an absolute amount of money, it's they just want to make a little bit more than the person who's making the most money right now before they arrived. They want to be on the top, and they know that will make them happy. Whatever number that is, that's not the point. We could wrap up a little bit, and we could give some advice to our miserable king we saw earlier. One thing is he does seem depressed, so I think antidepressants and cognitive behavioral therapy probably would help. We could work on some of the environmental influences that are making him miserable. His absolute income is great. His relative income is great. His status is fine. Maybe he could move the castle to a quieter part of the kingdom. And I guess I can't resist saying this, and this isn't so much grounded in specific empirical psychology, but also just a broader moral view, which is I think we get the most satisfaction, the most sustained benefit from long-term relationships and projects. So I think he should give up on his concubines, find a queen, join a club, and get involved in some charities to help other people.